will be safe to remain faithful with Him. Substance in the life of a believer has good morning once again, and welcome to our FB Live, brought to you by Barkadahan Kay Cristo Global Singapore. It's a beautiful Sunday morning, and thank you so much for participating once again in this FB Live. I really appreciate your kindness and your faithfulness of being with us in this media, in this fellowship online. Thank you, and I just want you to relax, and we will bring you the continuation of the book of Jonah chapter 1. Really excited to bring it to you. But before anything else, I encourage you to become a kingdom investor. Now on your screen we have our DBS account, which is 106902424-2, 106902424-2, and that is the DBS current account of Barkadahan Kay Cristo. You can deposit your tithes, offering, love gift through that account, or you can also through this QR code. Okay, just open your cell phone and point that camera on this QR code, and this will link you to the web page. On your screen, on your cell phone, just press the arrow and this will link you to our Give webpage. Or you can also go directly to our website, which is www.bkkfellowship.org, and in that Give support, just press that Give support and this will link you to our Give webpage, wherein you need to fill up all the information down there. Okay, once you do that, you completed everything, don't forget to press make donation. And once you do that, we will be prompt with an email saying your donation, your love gift, your tithe, your offering has been received by Barkadahan Kay Cristo with this amount. Thank you so much. Easy as that. Very convenient nowadays. Technology is really, really on your hands. Just use that technology, and yep, easy as that. But before anything else, let me pray for you before we move on to our topic for this Sunday. Let's just bow down our head and let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the generosity, thank you for the kindness, thank you for the love of all these people, Lord God. Not only the members of Barkadahan Kay Cristo, but as well as those whom we don't know, Father God, but really helping us in this ministry that you had given us. Thank you, Lord God, for the kindness, generosity. And I pray, Lord, in return, that they will receive, Lord God, press down, shake it together, running over. Your promise, Lord God, to them will manifest in the name of Jesus, and they will receive in full. Thank you, Lord, that even in this time of situation, they are all safe, Lord God, and they are all blessed in the name of Jesus. Cover them always with your precious blood, Lord, and protect them and make them safe, Lord God. Make them safe always in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, and I ask in Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Thank you so much, wonderful people of the Lord. And let me bring you to our topic for this Sunday. And this is the continuation of our topic, Away from God. Away from God. It's a wonderful story. The story in the Bible never changes. It's the same. It's about the love of God. It's about the compassion of the Lord. And this is what God wants us to hear. And on your screen, we already have this Jonah chapter 1, 1 to 16. And please read with me. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for the wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found the ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. Then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God, and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest part of the ship, and had lain down, and was fast asleep. So the captain came to him and said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us, so that we may not perish." And they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us." So they cast lots, and lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation, and where do you come from? What is your country, and of what people are you?" So he said to them, "I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, "Why have you done this?" For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then they said to him, "What shall we do to you, that the sea may be calm for us?" For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, "Pick up and throw me into the sea, then the sea will become calm for you. For I know that this great tempest is because of me." Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to the land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, "We pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you." So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and offered a sacrifice to the Lord, and took vows. Thank you so much. It's lengthy, but it's worth. Now you have read chapter 1 of Jonah. And let us just have a recap of what we studied last Sunday. Okay, verse 1 and verse 2, there are two things that God wants Jonah to do. First is he wants him to go to Nineveh, and that is the command of God. And the second one is that he said in verse 2, and the cry out against cry out against it, because the wickedness has come up before me. He wants Jonah to go there and tell the people, or rebuke the people. Rebuke is so-called the scold the people, and tell them that their wickedness reached God. Hallelujah. And this is how lovely and how beautiful our God is. He is truly a loving God. You see, he knows that the Ninevites were sinning against him. So he asked his servant Jonah to go there and ask them to repent from their sins. And how wonderful this is. And you can see that the heart of God is not for judgment as per se, but the heart of God is always for repentance, that the people will repent and go back to his presence and walk in the righteousness of God. And this is the very heart of the Lord. And now the decision will fall unto men, whether you will accept the invitation of God, and will you accept to repent before him. And that is the call for all humanity. Now, this is our part. The part of God is to ask us, invite us to come again, to join him. Hallelujah. To repent from our sins and return back to him and be with him forevermore. And this is the very love of God. And even that the Gentiles had this invitation coming from the Lord. And how wonderful that is. And the second one is that Jonah refused to go to Nineveh, rather than he took that ship and in going to Tarshish. And along the way, we've seen that there was trouble and there is typhoon, hallelujah, and all are we're in chaos. And the one thing why Jonah did not go to Nineveh, or reluctant to go there, because of the people. And according to our study, this Nineveh is the city of a city of progress. They are huge and big in commerce, in everything. And the people there is were quite wealthy as well. But according to Nahum chapter 3, aside from that, is a very bad story for this city. Because according to Nahum chapter 3, this city is very bad. This city is full of murderers. This city is full of people, lies. And these people are hunting you, hallelujah, and want you to be killed. And this is the lives of the people in Nineveh. So this is the many reasons that Jonah may be reluctant to go there. And he wants God to have his judgment over the Ninevites because of this condition. But to God, if there's still life, you still have hope. And this hope is taken by the Lord in such a way that people can repent and return back to Him. And He's a very, very good God. And He is a very loving God, merciful God, and gracious God. And He is still the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Okay? And I would like to continue with verse 5 to 6. And let me, let me proceed there, 5 and 6. Now, this is item 2, which is God prevents Jonah's escape. And verses 5 to 6 says, the sailors of the ship seek their superstitious gods. Okay, and verses 5 to 6 says, then the mariners were afraid, and every man cried out to his God, and threw their cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down into the lowest part of the ship, had lain down, and was fast asleep. So the captain came to him and said to him, what do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps the God will, your God will consider us so that we may not perish. Okay, so the captain wants Jonah as well to cry out before his God, because everyone was turning, hallelujah, to their own God. They are crying out loud and begging their God, praying to their God, hallelujah. And this is what happened when men do his best to fix everything. Like for instance, here in this story, they throw the cargo on the sea, you know, just to lighten up the load. But actually God is expecting that all of us will come to Him first before doing our own thing. But humanity, or human, is different. Now for us, we do our thing first. We kind of fix up the problem and try to resolve it in our own way, in our own strength, in our own ideas. And when we fall short and came up failed, then that's the part that we call upon the Lord. And this is what happened as well in this situation. Now they cried out loud to God, but before that they throw everything down to the sea. And when they found out that it doesn't help at all, now they cried out to their God, hallelujah. And of course, when these things are not enough, if we are not what we are doing is not effective, we try to turn to God. And that is the point in time that we are turning back to the Lord and asking God for help. And I would say that first and foremost, we should come to God and ask God for His help rather than doing our own thing, because coming to the very presence of God reveals more things. The Holy Spirit will be able to teach us and tell us what to do. There will be guidance spiritually coming from the Holy Spirit. So we need to come to God first before doing our stuff, because we know for the fact that it's always a failure. We need God to guide us. We need the Holy Spirit to guide us, our mind, our hearts, our thinking, for us to come up with a very good solution. And in this instance, we see that even though they already done everything, still they cannot stop the raging waves, and they cannot stop the storm. And if we don't know the true God and the God of the Bible before we are in trouble, we may sincerely turn to a false God. And this is the problem right now. If we don't have that relationship with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and sometimes when we are in trouble and when we ask God for help, sometimes there are things that He will say, okay, I will answer that. Okay, I will let you wait. Or okay, I will not answer that. And if you don't know the Lord whom you serve, is this three, you could not get the exact answer from God. And it's kind of confusion that you will turn to other gods, and you will find the ways and means wherein you can resolve the issue. Hallelujah. So people that says they believe in the Lord must have this really faith in God, knowing that God can do things and knowing God can fix things. We must have that faith in the Lord, whether or not He will calm the sea or not, the storms of our life, it's up to Him. But our part is to trust Him, because He knows what He is doing, and He is a loving God and a perfect God. So many people also assume that they can put off doing their business with God until they choose a better time to do it. Hallelujah. That's why they will act of coming before the Lord when they have no choice at all. That is the time that they will come to the very presence of God. And it's also presumptuous to think that if you don't know the God whom you serve, the God that the universe or the Bible is presenting to you, it's really presumptuous to think that you will be able to call the true God. Amen. If you don't have any relationship with the true God, when crisis comes, I don't think you will be able to call the true God. It is only when you have this relationship with Him, it is only when you know Him so well, it is when that you have this bonding with Him, you talk to Him often, and you're really abiding in His love, in His grace, and in His righteousness. Okay, or else you will be able to call other gods. Now remember that if human is in the panic mode, hallelujah, there's a tendency that he will call other gods. There is a tendency that he will seek help from others if he cannot get the answer from the true God. Hallelujah. And this is very dangerous. This is very dangerous. So we must have that true relationship with the Lord. Let us maintain that, you know, as a believer in Christ. Whether God will answer that today or God will answer that tomorrow, let's just depend on God. Let's just trust God, because God knows everything and He knows what is best for all of us. Okay, and also in verse 2 he said, was fast asleep. Hallelujah. Was fast asleep. While the storm raging, Jonah slept, perhaps because the storm outside seemed insignificant to him in comparison to the storm that is inside his heart. And sometimes he neglect to notice that there is storm going on. Hallelujah. That there is raging waves. Hallelujah. That rocking their boat. Hallelujah. Or their ship. And because he is in the condition that he is also fighting for himself, the call of the Lord. Hallelujah. And it's greater what he felt inside, that struggle that inside of him, that he knew for the fact that he ran away from the Lord. That's why I think he just fall asleep and try to get away from the outside situation, even from the inside the situation that he is experiencing. Okay, and what as curious as a tragic scene that we have read a while ago, all the sailors were religious. Hallelujah, they are devout in their prayers to their own gods, yet their gods were really nothing and could do nothing at all. Hallelujah, they can't calm the sea. And I remember Elijah as well, when he challenged all the prophets of Baal, and he said, okay, you must chant more, you must sing more, you do more, maybe your God's still sleeping. Hallelujah. And exactly with this situation, they are calling to their gods, but unable to calm the sea, the raging waves. Hallelujah. And sad to know that there is one man who knows everything, who knows what's going on in that moment, but really falling asleep, really, hallelujah, ignored everything. There was and he was on that board, hallelujah, he was on that ship, and he had this relationship with the true God, and he knew the very word of the Lord, and he is a worshiper of God, yet he was asleep. That is the sad story, not only in the life of Jonah, but in the life of many believers who really neglect who they are, and sometimes some of them abandoned their position as a believer, and running after the things of the world, enjoying the things of the world. And that is really a sad story. It's like Jonah who fall asleep during this turmoil time. Hallelujah. And I will show you what Spurgeon say. Jonah was asleep amid all the confusion and noise. And O Christian man, for you be indifferent to all that is going on in such a world as this. For you to be negligent of God's work in such time as this is just a strange. The devil alone is making noise enough to wake all the Jonah if there's only one to wake. All around us there is tumult and storm. Yet some professing Christians are able, like Jonah, to go to sleep in the sides of the ship. Yes, hallelujah, those raging seas, those issues that we are facing right now, hallelujah. And sometimes this will be used by the enemy to arrow our minds and our heart, to confuse us of what is going on, telling us to go to other gods, because our God is enabled to do great things and enabled to fix these things. Hallelujah. So there's an arrow from the devil telling us that turn away from your God and go to other gods, do other means, maybe it will resolve the issue. Hallelujah. And Spurgeon is true enough, hallelujah, when he said that all around us is turmoil and the storm, yet some professing Christians are able to like Jonah, to go to sleep in the sides of the ship. This is the time to pray. This is the time to commune with the Lord. This is the time to communicate and have relationship with God. Hallelujah. This is the time. This is a perfect time. And this is the reason why God, hallelujah, allowed this to happen, for us to have a good relationship with Him and to trust Him even more. Hallelujah. We have seen every country is trying to progress with the research of the vaccine, but until now, hallelujah, there's no result at all. And this will be, this is just my opinion, let's just give it all to the Lord and trust God by His might and by His grace and mercy. He will be able to give the intelligence, hallelujah, to all those researchers and come up with the vaccine. And it's not possible with God, hallelujah, it's not impossible with the Lord, it's possible with God. And the nature of Jonah's sleep is also instructive and too much like the sleep of a careless Christian, and I will share that to you. Jonah sleep in a place where he hoped no one would see him or disturb him. Sleeping Christian like to hide among the church. Yes, and there are some who quote unquote say believer, and when they hit by the word of God, they will run away from the church. They will go to the church wherein their itching ear would like to hear something good and something so-called inspiring to their ear, and it's more favorable to them. Rather than God is confronting them to turn away from their sin, they don't like that. So as again, which is true, hallelujah, they are like Jonah, who sleep in a place where he hope no one would see him or disturb him. Sleeping Christian likes to hide among the church, hallelujah. Jonah sleep in a place where he could not help with work that needed to be done. Sleeping Christians stay away from the work of the Lord. Now every one of us have been told by Matthew, in the book of Matthew chapter 28, 19 to 20, that we must carry on the baton, looking for someone who is unsaved and bring the good news to them and bring them to the very presence of God. And this is the mandate of the Lord to each and every one of us. And if you are honest enough to yourself, you kind of ask yourself whether this is really working in your life, or this is now dead in your life, the mandate that God has told us to do. So if we are not doing this, we are like Jonah, who also fall asleep and having no sense of the urgency of sharing the good news to the people. And one more thing, Jonah slept while there was a prayer meeting up on the deck. Sleeping Christians don't like prayer meetings, hallelujah. Whether you like it or not, this is the truth. And sometimes truth hurts, but the hurts, hallelujah, will set us free. And this is what God wants to all of us, hallelujah, for us to realize that if you say that you are a believer, you must be inclined in prayer meetings, hallelujah, congregational meetings, hallelujah, and all those. But if you are not doing so, this will be a big question to yourself, hallelujah. That's why I told you many times that the word of the Lord doesn't change. It's the same. God is seeking our hearts, wants our hearts to be aligned to the hearts of God, hallelujah. It's not all about us. It's not all about the blessing. It's not all about being prosperous. It's not all about being wealthy, but it's about being righteous in the sight of God. And this is the call of the Bible. And even in the book of Jonah, the book of Habakkuk, and even in the life of John the Baptist, it's all the same. God is pointing us to one thing, and that is repentance. If we are in this condition, God is asking us to repent, hallelujah. And repentance means obeying the very word of the Lord, hallelujah, and accepting the invitation of God, hallelujah. And one more thing, Jonah slept and had no idea of problems around him. Sleeping Christians don't know what is really going on, hallelujah. Especially if you are not, if you are a member of a church and you are not participating in that worship Sunday service, you don't know what's going on in the church, because the message of the Lord is in that church, hallelujah, will reveal to the minister of God, hallelujah, and will convey to the people. And if you are not listening, and if you are not participating in this FB Live, you don't know anything. You don't know nothing. You don't know what is happening in the church and what is the message of God in the church. So it is very important, if you belong to the family of Christ in a certain church, you must attend there. You must listen to them. You must listen to the message of the Lord for you to get the exact message of God for that ministry. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. And Jonah slept when he was in great danger. Sleeping Christians are in danger but don't know it, hallelujah. And this time we are in the pandemic, we are not supposed to sleep alone, but also to pray, to study the word, hallelujah, seek God, seek his face, and to be in his very presence every minute, every hour, and every day, and every month, and every year, hallelujah, as long as you live. We need that, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Jonah slept while he heathen needed him. Sleeping Christians knows on while the world needs their message and testimony. We need to come out. Even we are in this lockdown, hallelujah, we have the media, we have the platform. we have the tool to bring the good news, the message to the people. It's not impossible nowadays. It's possible. All you have to do is to be faithful, hallelujah, and be useful to the ministry of the Lord, hallelujah. Convey the message, convey God, convey the salvation of the Lord to the people. Many people are crying out, are desperate right now to seek and to know the truth. And you, as the Jonah of God, needs you, hallelujah. No, and sometimes what we are doing, when someone asks us and need of a prayer, we will give them the number of the pastor. Here is the number of the pastor, call our pastor and seek for help and seek for the prayer. No, you yourself, hallelujah, is able to do that by the help of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Hallelujah. And of course, if you are really new believer, you can give that to me and I will take care of that as well. Okay, some sleeping Christians protest that they are not asleep at all. Hallelujah. We talk about Jesus, but you said, if you are not asleep, then let's talk about Jesus. If you say that you are awake, then let's talk about Jesus. If you say that you are not asleep, then we have a walk for Jesus, okay? We need to do that. Hallelujah. Just to disagree of what you said, that you are not asleep, okay? So let's do that. We have a walk for Jesus. And we have passion for Christ. Hallelujah. Just a few days back, hallelujah, during the worship, I cried out to God. I cried before the very presence of God. And if you are asleep, you cannot do this. There's no feeling at all because you don't know what's going on. If you say that you are not asleep, then let's have compassion with Jesus. Let's have compassion with Christ. Let's worship Him daily in our lives, every minute, every day and every week and every month of our lives. Let's worship Him forevermore. We have joy and rejoice in Jesus Christ. If you say that you are not asleep, then let's rejoice. Let's rejoice in Jesus. And you know that joy, it doesn't come from the things of the world, but it comes from the fellowship with God. It comes from reading the word of the Lord. It comes from the prayer. It comes from sharing the good news to the people. And if you are not asleep, then let's do this. We think about Jesus at all times. Hallelujah. But you think you are asleep, then if you say and you are not doing this, I think you are only daydreaming. Hallelujah. You are not really awake. You are still fall asleep. And you, if you say you are not, then let's do all these things. Now let's move on to verse 6. Verse 6 says, so the captain came to him and said to him, what do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish. Hallelujah. The captain knew that his crew cried to their gods, but it did not do anything. No, it did not resolve the issue. And perhaps Jonah's God could do something in this crisis. Hallelujah. And sometimes it's shameful when somebody asks you that, let us pray, maybe you can lead us in prayer, and you will not able to lead the prayer. And you are 16 years of a Christian, having relationship with God, and you cannot do all these things. It's shame in the name of Jesus. So we need to do that. We need to guide the people. We need to call our God, because they know for the fact that you are a believer and you know the true God. Hallelujah. That's why some of the people will ask you for help, hallelujah, spiritually, and you must be prepared. Let's move on to 7 and 8 of Jonah. The sailors discovered that Jonah is the source of trouble. Verse 7, and they said to one another, come, let us cast lots that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Hallelujah. And it's hard to know what motivates the sailor to think that the storm was sent because one of them had wronged their God. Hallelujah. No one can resolve the issue when they call to God. So it's a kind of I'm wondering how come they would ask Jonah to call upon his God, or this situation is caused by God. Hallelujah. Perhaps it's because of some spiritual insight Or I might say that this is also the divine intervention of the Holy Spirit for them to realize that this storm, this kind of a situation, cannot be done by somebody else but the most powerful God of the universe. And maybe this is what prompted them, hallelujah, to have this insight, to call upon God, hallelujah, the sense of spiritual power in that storm, hallelujah. And the lot fell on Jonah. And once the lot fell on Jonah, the sailors wanted to know as much as they could from Jonah so they could solve the problem and save their lives. Hallelujah. In verse 8, we can see that it says, they said to him, please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble upon us? What is your occupation? And where do you came from? And what country? And what people are you? Hallelujah. In 2 Kings, I will share that to you, 14:25. Says that Jonah was recognized prophet. Jeroboam took back Israel's land, which ran from the Lebo Hamath to the Arabah Sea. This happened as the Lord of Israel had told his servant Jonah, son of Amittai, the prophet from Gath-Hepher. Okay, hallelujah. So he was a prominent prophet. Everyone knows Jonah, actually. So when Jonah was asked, what is your occupation? And he answered, prophet. Then the sailors were more terrified. Hallelujah. And it's kind of funny to know sometimes, hallelujah, that, I think I've done that before when I was in Philippine Airlines. And my sister-in-law attended the basketball tournament, and I was one of the players there. My colleague told her that about my naughty things that I was doing during that time, and my sister-in-law says that he is a believer, and he's kind of get shocked. A believer doing these things is a question mark, and seems like here I can relate that to the questions that pointed by the sailors, no, to Jonah. And when Jonah said, I'm a prophet, what? A running away prophet? That's why we have this situation. We are in this condition. That's why we are in this turmoil. Because you, hallelujah, run away from the God of the universe. Amen. And it's not good. It's shameful to know that we are a believer running away from the very presence of God because we don't want to follow the call, the command of God. Now in verse 9 to 10, and it says, Jonah tells them about who he is and what he has done. So he said to them, I am a Hebrew and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven who made the sea and the dry land. Hallelujah. Jonah knew the truth that God is the God of the universe. God is the God of the sea and the dry land. Even though he claimed to fear the Lord, was only partly true because he was running from God. Hallelujah. And I think before he said this, he already came to a point that he remorsed. And he really saddened with what he has done before the Lord, I think. That's why he said, I fear the Lord, the God of heaven who made the sea and the dry land. Okay, but even though he said this, it's also partly true because of what he has done. He ran away from the Lord. So even a believer who is in a state of rebellion can give glory to God, and if he will only tell the truth about the Lord. If we will just reveal what is the truth about God, even the unbeliever can say that. Hallelujah. That the God of the Hebrew, the God of the believers, the God of the Christian is the God of the universe. Although it is tragic that Jonah's life contradicts his knowledge about God. And sometimes we might say that we are a believer, that we are not walking the talking, okay? And sometimes this, hallelujah, contrasts our very lives. Our testimony of quote-unquote being a believer sometimes contrasts with what people seen in us, what people heard when we talk something else, hallelujah, and they kind of puzzled and thinking that is it true that he is a believer? Or is it true that she is a believer? And I don't think so, because apart from that life that he is showing us or testifying to us, it's really, really far. Hallelujah. So, hallelujah. At that moment, Jonah said, I fear the Lord. He may have already repented. Hallelujah. As what I've told you, of running away and turning back to God because of the present circumstances. So verse 10, and he said, then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, what have you done? Why have you done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. So why you have done this? Hallelujah. Even a believer who knows the truth, hallelujah, God rightly rebuked a Christian who is resisting God. And it's really shameful because our name tag came with the name Christ before it's Ian, right? The full Christian name. And whatever we do, it's really a testimony, and it's really shameful in that name tag Christ that is in us. Hallelujah. So we must be very careful. We must obey God. We must do the things of God rather than running away from the presence of God. Hallelujah. And why have you done this? They ask. It's most logical question that the world, even for unbeliever, to ask a believer, what have you done? Hallelujah. And why you say so? Well, why it's conflict to your life. And what you have said, hallelujah, it's kind of off from the name tag that you have. It's really a question, and they can ask that, of course, to all of us. Now, 11 to 16, Jonah, at his own request, asked to be thrown into the sea, and the sailors reluctantly agree. 11, and what shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us? For the sea was growing more, and he said, hallelujah, just, hallelujah, throw me into that sea. So the more sailors hear, the worse the situation gets. The sea was growing more tempestuous. Hallelujah. It's really, really raging. Hallelujah. And it's scary. Hallelujah. And in verse 12, he said, pick me up and throw me into the sea, that the sea will become calm for you. For I know that the great tempest is because of me. Hallelujah. Jonah was willing to sacrifice his life to save everyone else on the ship. Hallelujah. And this is the part where he come to his senses that he really needs to obey God, and this is a no way out kind of situation. And sometimes this is the only time that we realize that we need to follow the command of the Lord. If things get worse, if we are into the situation, we are cornered, hallelujah, and cannot get away from that situation, or we cannot do anything about it, then that's the time that we surrender to the Lord. Why come to that point? If at first we can just obey God and follow God, hallelujah, anyway, that is the call. It's not only God will love us, but also in return, we must God love, hallelujah, love God all the more. And we must obey God, hallelujah. We may consider what his motive might have been. Perhaps it was a compassion for the sailor. Perhaps it was a desire to force into a complete dependence upon God alone. After all, there is no safer place than casting yourself totally upon God. And perhaps it was a feeling that anything was better than his continual resistance against and running from the Lord. Or perhaps because he had already truly repented. If this is the case, it illustrates that repentance is not only a matter of heart and mind, but it's a matter of action, right? Hallelujah. And that is true. Hallelujah. If you say that you repented from your sin, you must turn away from your sin. Hallelujah. And you must not remain in that sin. There must be an action from you, from all of us who sinned against God. Hallelujah. And that's the only way that we can get away from that old situation. Now verse 13, and it says, nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to the land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Hallelujah. Now the sailors did not want to throw Jonah into the sea because they believed his God was for real, and they feared the consequences of throwing a prophet, even a disobedient prophet, actually. Hallelujah. So this is their call. They don't want to kill someone because they feared God. Hallelujah. And that's the good thing as well. Now Romans 8:28, not all is good, but God can make it good. Hallelujah. The situation will be in our favor as always, as God loves us. Hallelujah. And that is the case in the lives of Jonah. And even the sailors came to realize that they need to, hallelujah, and know this God, the God of the universe, the God who created this storm, hallelujah, and even later on calmed this storm. In verse 14, it says, I'm not sure if I have that. They prayed, therefore they cried out to the Lord and said, we pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased. So they turned to God, hallelujah. And that situation, hallelujah, it's like Romans 8:28, hallelujah. God can turn a nasty situation, a very bad situation, in a good situation, hallelujah, giving glory to our God. Now verse 15, so they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from its raging, hallelujah. Immediately, end of the storm, proved that Jonah's God was for real, and our God is a true God, and it's the same God, hallelujah, whom Jonah served. That Jonah's resistance to God was real problem, and it's the same with all of us. It's the same when we run away from the Lord, when we disobey God, hallelujah, there is always a consequence on it. And hallelujah, if you ask me, why running away from the Lord, why turn away from God, why disobey God, hallelujah, anyway, at the end of it, I will be facing God. So I might do all these things, hallelujah, and obey God and love God all the more, and trust Him completely and faithfully, for I know He is the God of the universe, hallelujah, and He is the God that can help me. No other gods, hallelujah, can help me with in every situation that I will face, hallelujah, only my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So the sailors moved from fearing the storm to fearing the Lord. Just the disciples in the boat did what Jesus calmed, hallelujah, the storms in Mark 4, hallelujah. They turned to Jesus, hallelujah, and acknowledged Jesus, hallelujah. And it's a beautiful story. We learn to see that Jesus was cast into the sea of divine wrath on our account. Memory can look back upon past sins with sorrow for the sin. It is true. But yet with no dread of penalty to come, because Jesus had taken all our sins at the cross of Calvary. And this is what is good to those who accepted Jesus as the Lord and personal Savior. Whether or not we are in the turmoil of life, we can assure, hallelujah, that the divine grace and the divine help of God will be there. And if we sin against God, that is not the end of the rope. Hallelujah. We can still go to the very presence of God and ask God for forgiveness and return to the Lord. Anyway, this is what God is looking for our repentance, hallelujah, for our heart to repent before Him. And God is so pleased and joyful to see people coming before Him, repenting from their sins, hallelujah, and receiving Him as the Lord and personal Savior. Now verse 16, then the man feared the Lord exceeding and offered the sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. Hallelujah. Notice that the vow of the sailor came after they were delivered. Based on this, many commentators believe that the sailor came to their true faith with God. Hallelujah. How awesome it is. And hallelujah. And God is really loving. Hallelujah. And God is really wonderful, reaching out people before their time, hallelujah, and even up to this time. It's the same calling by the Lord. It never changes. I'm not sure why we are changing the message of the Bible, the message of God. This is the true message of the Lord, reaching out people, calling people to repent, and asking those believers to be obedient in the very word of the Lord. Hallelujah. According to Spurgeon, sinners, when they are tossed upon the sea of the conviction, make desperate effort to save themselves. The fleshly effort of awakening sinners must inevitably fail, or the soul sorrows will continue to increase as long as it relies on its effort. The way of safety for sinners to be found in the sacrifice of another on their behalf. Yes, as long as we are not going to go to the true God and trying to do our own will, it's always desperate to know, hallelujah, that we will end up failure anyway. So why not try God? Why not go to the very presence of God? Hallelujah. All the help that we can get will be coming from the Lord alone and no one else. Because He is God of the universe. He is the God, hallelujah, who can save you and no one else. Hallelujah. Thank you so much and happy Sunday, everyone. And for those who wants to receive Christ as their Lord and personal Savior, please allow me to pray for you. And even for those who are sick right now, I can pray for you and ask God for His healing, divine healing to your physical body. And let us pray. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for reaching out to me this Sunday, Lord God. Thank you for the message that I can still repent from my sin. I can still go back, Lord God, to your presence. There is still time, Lord God, for me to return to your very presence. And I thank you, Lord, hallelujah, for loving me this much and this far. Lord God, I confess that I have sinned against you. And I can, Lord God, not remove my own sin. I need Jesus. I need the blood of Jesus to cleanse me from head to foot. And I receive Jesus as my Lord and personal Savior. Lord, I thank you. Write my name in the book of life. And thank you, Father, for receiving me as a child of God, now and forevermore. Lord, I ask you to reign my life. Lord, I ask you to navigate my life. Lord, I ask you to drive my life and even pilot my life, now and forevermore. And Lord, I thank you in the name of Jesus to those, Father God, who needs healing right now physically, to those who are suffering from cancer, to those who are suffering, Lord God, from sickness and disease, and even, Lord God, suffering from this COVID-19 infection. Lord, thank you that you are a healer. Thank you, Lord God, that the manifestation of healing, Lord God, is now manifesting, Lord, in the lives of these people. And the touch of the Holy Spirit, hallelujah, is now, Father God, in these lives and in this physical body of all these sick people, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, let the blood of Christ cleanse them from head to foot. And Lord, I proclaim, I decree, I speak, Lord God, healing in their lives. Hallelujah. They are healed. They are well. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen and amen. Thank you so much. All glory, all honor, all praise, all thanksgiving, all worship belongs to Christ alone. Happy Sunday, everyone. God bless.